Order, maybe start. Before we get to the business of the cabinet, I just want to say a few words about the sad death of former councillor Walter Smith. Many accolades have been paid to Walter, but I think it's right and fitting that the first cabinet following his passing, we just take a minute to reflect on what a fantastic public servant Walter was over 40 years on rural council and previous councils. Anybody who knew Walter would testify he was a consummate gentleman, a wonderful councillor for Bebington, very selfless and giving his time to his residents and the constituents, and he will be sadly and badly missed by everybody on rural council. So can I invite us to stand for a minute silence, please? Thank you. Thank you. Okay, so let's go into the agenda. Item one is members' code of conduct. Do any members of cabinet wish to declare any interest? Stuart.
There's an interest in respect to item six as a board member of the gentleman.
Okay, thank you, Stuart. Any other cabinet members wish to declare any interest? Okay. Item two is the minutes of the last meeting. Can I agree that I'll sign the entry record?
Agree.
On to cabinet member reports. Item four is the strategic asset acquisition, the Europa building. I'm going to ask George Davis to introduce this report, please, George.
I think the actual summary of the first cabinet into where we are actually moving over the next year or so. We've placed 5,000 new jobs, which at the cause of the building of new investments into the world by 2020. This is a bold and ambitious move, and we are absolutely committed to regeneration in our work. And we're not going to stop until we have created a thriving local economy where our residents have the opportunity and can access good, high-paying jobs on their doorsteps. I think that comes to be very important. Important part of the actual documents. This proposal is yet more proof of the commitment to that pledge, following recent announcements of the state of the art student accommodation development in Arden Square and plans to open grants to the world renowned Eureka Children's Museum to Will. It is clear that we are building what we call real momentum. Later this year, we will announce the next stage of the development of the Will of Growth Company, a radical and ambitious new venture which will drive forward the development of many areas of our borough. bringing key sites such as the Europa building into public ownership allows us to restore the Fitted Town Centre back to a former glory in a much quicker time frame. This report seeks members' approval to acquire the property known as the Europa building on Europa Square, Birkenhead. The purchase of the building forms part of the strategic acquisition programme that supports the key economic goals and aspirations of the council as set out in the strategic regeneration framework and world growth plan. The Europa building is the first of a number of strategic acquisitions that council will be undertaking to create these opportunities. Strategic case for acquisition is set out in the report below. However, the commercial details of the proposal is contained in the attached appendix, which is exempt from publication. The acquisition of the building supports the business category of the 2020 pledges, and in particular, the targets of securing £250 million of private sector investments during the lifetime of the plan, along with the pledge to create greater job opportunities in Wirral. The proposal is not only to awards, and the proposed acquisition of the Europa Centre is a key decision for the council. I move this recommendation.
Okay, so this is part of the plan to regenerate the borough, but this is the kind of new way of doing regeneration, which will give us an ongoing revenue stream, which is really important in the context of the funding cuts that we've made to our budget. So I think this is the first in a number of these acquisitions that we'll see come to cabinet. And I think it's entirely aligned with our plan about how we, bring in new revenue streams to the council, and it also will form a key site and a key building as part of the Birkenhead Town Centre, which is a key priority for the regeneration plans going forward. And it also will dovetail into our plans for a growth company, more details of which we'll bring to a future cabinet. Okay, so we've got recommendations in front of us on page 4 that Council requires you to build on the terms report, so that's a confidential appendix which we'll deal with later on in the market session. So can Cabinet agree with that recommendation?
Thank you.
Thank you. Which takes us on to item 5, disposal of land at Sorrel Massey Road to the Merseyside Fire Rescue Service. So George?
Phil. This report seeks members' approval for the disposal of land at Sorrel Massey to Merseyside Fire Rescue Authority for the construction of a new community fire station. Members will be aware of the fire station emergency programme currently being undertaken by Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority. One of the planned mergers involves the closure of Upton and West Kirby fire stations with the construction of a new station in a central location to cover both areas. A range of alternative sites have been considered, and the most suitable in terms of emergency response has been identified on Sorrel Massey Road. The land is within Greenbelt, and Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority have had to demonstrate very special circumstances in planning terms to allow the proposal. The transfer of land is proposed by way of a long lease rather than an outright sale, as this will enable the council to better control the future use of the site. The tenure is leased for 150 years. Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority will pay the council £42,000 at a peppercorn rent. I just want to make but in this position, because it will not be for the total government slashing the budgets of the fire authority, then we would not be discussing this item here this morning.
Okay, thanks George. And I think that last point is well made, that we are only in the position of having to consider this because of the decimation of the fire authority budget by the government, which is forcing the fire authority to have to make some incredibly difficult decisions about prioritising resources, and this obviously impacts on individual boroughs in different ways, and this is the main impact at the moment on Wirral. The only thing I wanted to add to the comments George had made is that we've been through an extensive process on this item. It's gone through all the appropriate legal channels. It's been agreed by planning committee. The revised application has been agreed by planning committee. It's not been waived in, but called in by the Secretary of State, the Conservative Secretary of State, not called it in. So that they've given it the green light. And I think now we just need to get on with this, because at the end of the day, this will save lives. This is about the 26,000 households in the area covered, and this will save lives. And if that's not our number one priority on this council, I don't know what it is. I think, frankly, some of the politicking around this has been shameful. And I do think it's something we need to get on with. The other thing I wanted to refer to is a letter that I received from Councillor Blakely, Councillor Berry, and Councillor Williams at 6 minutes past 11 last night. Actually, after I was asleep, but never mind. And it was a letter asking me to instruct Cabinet not to go ahead with this transfer. And it attached a petition purporting to be of 1,170 signatures. I've taken some legal advice on this petition. Actually, it's not 1,170 signatures, it's 816 signatures. And actually, looking at the signatures, I say this in all sincerity, I think some of these entries are at very least questionable. So I noticed that a number of Conservative councillors have signed this petition multiple times. So just to give you a couple of examples, so Councillor Berry signed it twice, Councillor Rowlands has signed it three times, Councillor Steve Williams has signed it three times, Councillor Burgess Joyce has signed it three times, or somebody called David Burgess Joyce, I presume that's Councillor Burgess Joyce, with three separate addresses. Three, Manchester and Walsall. And so it goes on. Councillor Clements has signed it twice. And there were a number of signatories here from areas way outside Wirral. So Israel, Tenerife. What I'm getting around to saying, Cabinet, is I think at the very least some of these signatures are legally questionable. And I'd be taking advice from the head of law as to whether the entries here do make this an invalid petition. And where councillors have signed it multiple times, I'll be taking advice from the head of law as whether that represents a standards matter. So I'll acknowledge the letter that I've had from the ward members, but I do have to raise serious concerns about the validity of this petition. So I'll just make that point in public, and I'll await the legal response, and I'll give this to Vicky to come back to me once she's had a chance to consider the questions that we've asked. So notwithstanding that, I'll ask you to look at the recommendations which George has moved on page 9, that the land identified and transferred to the Fire and Rescue Authority by way of a long lease for the construction of a new fire station. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Okay, that takes us on then to item number 6, approval of the business case and consultation approach for the proposed introduction of selective licensing. And George, this is you again, please.
Thank you, Bill. The approval of the business case and consultation approach for the proposed extension of selective licensing is something that I really do welcome. I think most people in the council will welcome. And one of the only things I want to start by saying is that when this first started, we were advised to take it in small chunks. And we did on Will, and we picked out four areas which were picked out, not by us, but they said these are the four areas you really need to tackle at this present moment in time. We did that, and so therefore we don't believe that, and also now governments have now changed the ruling to this, so I want to make this point abundantly clear. Liverpool, when they first went at the same time as us, welfare and blanket cover for all of the good. And it's realistically, it's not, it doesn't work. You have to take on extra staff, you have to have extra time, extra resource. We're meeting that obligation on the road. We're meeting that and we're moving forward very quickly. And I'd say that the wheel scheme is recognised in the North West as one of the best. So I just wanted to make that point. So when people say to you, why is there only four, that's the reason behind it. So Wiggles' existing selective licensing scheme, which was introduced in July 2015, has demonstrated that in some areas of the private rental sector, the council needs to step in and ensure housing is of the right quality. Less than one in three properties inspected in the current scheme meet the required standard. So this approach is necessary to ensure that Wiggles residents all have the opportunity to live in good quality, safe and attractive housing. This scheme contributes to the Wiggles Plan 2020 pledge, good quality housing which meets the needs of residents by improving the quality of housing for our residents, which is a key component of Wiggles' housing strategy, as well as improving health outcomes for all residents living in these areas. This report explains how the scheme works and proposes a comprehensive 12-week consultation programme to investigate the potential rolling the scheme out to an additional four areas in East Wirral. These four areas have been selected by a robust evidence base which has analysed data to highlight areas where there are high concentrations of rented properties, low demand and poor property conditions, and where the evidence supports government's guidance on conditions needed for the introduction of a new scheme. The areas proposed to extend the scheme are Hamilton Square, Seacombe St Paul's, Birkenhead West and Birkenhead Central. Selective licensing is a scheme to improve private rented sector homes within specific neighbourhoods by requiring private landlords to obtain a 5-year licence and comply with certain agreed conditions. Landlords must also be a fit and proper person to hold the licence. Wiggles' current scheme includes just over 1,300 privately rented properties and the proposal is to double the number of areas where the scheme is designated. The proposal supports a targeted approach in specific areas where problems have been demonstrated rather than a blanket approach that had been applied for in some of the local authorities. The business case which supports the extension of the scheme is attached to this report, and members are asked to agree that this evidence is the subject to a strategy consultation exercise to seek wider views on the proposal. The licensing conditions have been updated to respond to feedback and lessons learned from the existing selective licensing scheme. So therefore, members are requested to A, approve the draft proposals for implementing selective licensing in the additional four proposed areas in the borough based on the robust evidence base. B, approve the consultation plan and draft business cases attached to this report as the basis for public consultation on selective licensing. And C, give delegated authority to the Cabinet Member for Housing, Community Safety and Head of Operational Housing Services to undertake minor amendments to the business case should further evidence be made available, which should be included in the consultation.
Thanks, George. Okay, any comments on this? Jeanette and Phil.
Thanks, Phil. Thanks, George. I'm really pleased to see this. I think this is an example of how the Labour administration is making a real difference here in such straitened times. I mean, far too long, I think only some private landlords have gotten away with far too much. I think it's widely acknowledged that your decent standard of housing is one of the biggest determinants of good mental and physical health. And I feel that for people on low income, that's often been denied to the one world. So I'm really pleased to see, I was really pleased to see our original scheme, and I'm so pleased that this has been rolled out.
Okay, thank you, Phil.
Cheers, Phil. Really to repeat what Jeanette said, to discuss this scheme, I'm sure you can see it being rolled out and it being one of your priorities, and there it is. You mentioned in the first part of your presentation the fact that government has changed the rules on whether this can cannot be implemented. Can you just confirm basically with the mayors?
Okay, I see you confirm it. What basically happened is governments have now come back, having seen, in particular at Liverpool, with a blanket cover completely away across the council, and found it is unworkable, and therefore I've recommended to all to do not take to a blanket cover.
Okay, and I just wanted to add to this. I think this is great news that we're able to roll this out. Let's just remind everybody that this administration initiated this selective licensing policy in 2015 when we put £350,000 into the budget to designate the first four areas. So this is a continuation of that policy. The report that we've got in front of you is very clear that the areas that have selective licensing within the private sector, rented sector, standards have gone up of the properties and the tenants and the landlords, which is exactly the purpose behind this initiative. It's great we'll be able to extend this further. Just to put to bed any accusations that this is kind of the cabinet picked the areas, the cabinet haven't picked the areas, this is the phrase that George used, I think was spot on. This has been done by an objective assessment through a robust evidence base of those areas that qualify under the kind of deprivation indices that are used. So this has not been a political decision, it's based on an objective analysis of need. And I'm really pleased that we're able to go further and designate these new areas, obviously subject to the public consultation exercise that will follow from the those agreements today. And I think finally from me, I think it is the determination, commitment of this administration to roll this out even further in future years into other areas. So we'll be looking to do that in due course. But we have the recommendations in front of you on page 16. So can they be agreed, Cabinet? Thank you very much. Which takes us then to the final item, which is item 7, integrated commissioning club. Chris.
People in the middle have told us that we want to improve a more fully integrated service in relation to their health and care. And this report supports a very important step as part of our approach to integrating health and care services. People want to tell their story once, and we've heard that so many times over the years. We're committed to having a fully joined up system for care and health, led by a single integrated commissioner for all aged health and care. They will coordinate and deliver the council and the CCGs all aged health care and public health commissioning functions. And I think for us from a council perspective, it's really important that we are there sitting at the table and have a wider approach to commissioning. Government cuts have meant that both council and all our health partners need to use resources in a more effective and a sustainable manner. And this approach will mean that we have a single planning process. There will be integrated teams, pooled budget, which geared up to deliver better outcomes and more responsive services for the people of Wirral. And we're already seeing really good evidence that by sitting in the same room and all making contributions, that's happening. The Commissioner will provide system leadership to make sure that the right care is delivered in the right place at the right time in order to help our residents to be as well and as independent as they can be, but with access to any services they need. So the recommendations in the paper are the Cabinet receive the full business cases appended to this report, that we know the content of the report, including the sections relating to due diligence, governance, and the target operating model, that a cabinet committee be established to sit alongside the CCG governing body of the NHS as a committee in common, rather than a joint committee, to oversee the work of the single integrated commissioner of the Wirral and to take such cabinet decisions as are required in respect of the council's relevant functions. Work continues with regard to the target operating governance arrangements and the implementation of a single commissioning arrangement for the 1st of April 2018. and a further progress report would be brought to Cabinet before that date in April.
Okay, thanks Chris. Comments, questions, Phil?
Thank you for that. I just wanted to congratulate Chris. This idea of integrating these two things has been on a late model for absolutely years. I know it's a horribly complicated thing to do, so if that were doing it here, it's absolutely brilliant. It's been on an episode for years, and it's good to finally see you coming to this action.
Okay, just to reiterate that, I've heard people say that this is about privatisation. Nothing to do with privatisation. This administration is completely wedded to the NHS principle about providing care free at the point of need. So this is not about doing that. This is about using our collective resources more sensibly. We've all said, haven't we, for years now, that given the government cuts, we can't continue to work in our silos. We've got to get out of our silos. So this is about the council and the NHS working together to use those resources more wisely. And we all talked about the rural pound, using the rural pound wisely, and this will enable us to do that. So it's entirely in line with our direction of travel on this council to make sure that do use our resources more effectively. But more importantly, Chris, I think we did hit the nail on the head. This will be good for the patients because they will only have to tell their story once. At the moment, it is too fragmented, and this is about having a more joined-up service that provides that one point of contact and one opportunity where people only have to tell their story to one set of professionals. So I personally think this is a no-brainer, and I think we should just get on with it. Okay, so we've seen we've heard the recommendations from Chris on page 137. They may agree? Okay, thank you. Now, before I conclude the public section of Cabinet, there's one final duty I do need to dispose of, and it's a pleasant duty. This is Tom Salt's final Cabinet. Tom, I know you're sitting quietly at the back, but it would be remiss, I think, of us if we didn't just mark this occasion by saying a huge thanks to Tom for 44 years of excellent service to the local authority. And I'm as leader, and I'm sure I speak on behalf of Cabinet, I'm sure I speak on behalf of actually all members, a huge thank you, Tom, for the fantastic work that you've done on behalf of the council and on behalf of rural residents over all of those years. And may we all send you warm wishes for a long and happy retirement. Thank you, Tom. Okay, so that ends the public cabinet. We've got a couple of confidential items we need to discuss. So at this point, I will move the appropriate resolution to the press and public. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
So can I please ask the press and public to please leave? Thank you for your attendance.